Good afternoon, colleagues. Before we begin, can I just remind members, as always, to observe the social distancing rules that are in place throughout the building, and particularly when entering and leaving the chamber. So our first item is a statement by the First Minister. The First Minister will take questions following her statement, and members may press their buttons to request a question whenever they wish. First Minister.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is required by law to review lockdown restrictions at least every 3 weeks. The latest review falls due today, and so I will set out our decisions and the next steps in our careful and cautious exit from lockdown. Firstly, though, I'll give an update on today's COVID statistics and a report on our progress in tackling the virus. Since yesterday, an additional 6 cases of COVID have been confirmed, which takes the total to 18,315. A total of 646 patients are currently in hospital with suspected or confirmed COVID, which is an overall decrease of 121 since yesterday, and that includes a decrease of 16 in the number of confirmed cases. As of last night, 9 people were in intensive care with confirmed or suspected COVID, which is a decrease of 2 on the number reported yesterday. And I'm very pleased to report that in the past 24 hours, no deaths have been registered of patients who had been confirmed as having the virus. The total number of deaths in Scotland under that measurement therefore remains at 2,490. However, we must never lose sight of the fact that every death is a tragedy, and I want to send my condolences to everyone who has lost a loved one to this illness. I also know that statistical trends don't console those who are grieving. However, the statistical trends are clear. In Scotland, COVID has now been suppressed to a low level. Indeed, even in the 3 weeks since I last updated Parliament, there has been significant progress. At that time, we were reporting approximately 20 new cases of COVID a day. The daily average now is around 7. 3 weeks ago, there were more than 540 people in hospital with confirmed COVID. The figure today is 342. And there are now just 3 patients with confirmed COVID in our intensive care units. The number of people dying has also fallen week on week, as is shown in our daily statistics and also in the weekly reports from National Records of Scotland. In addition, our latest modelling suggests that the R number remains below 1. It has been between 0.6 and 0.8 for most of the past month. And the number of people in Scotland with the virus continues to fall. 3 weeks ago, we estimated that around 2,900 people were infectious. Our estimate for last week is that around 1,000 people in Scotland were infectious. That confirms, as I explained yesterday when setting out our decision on air bridges, that prevalence of the virus in Scotland is at this stage several times lower than it is across the UK as a whole. Finally, in determining whether we can move from phase 2 to phase 3 of our exit from lockdown, we have assessed our progress in tackling COVID against the 6 criteria for this stage set out by the World Health Organization, and we have concluded that we meet each of them. However, I need to advise Parliament that the 5th of these criteria, which relates to managing the risk of importing cases from outside Scotland, did give us some pause for thought. The balanced decision we announced yesterday on air bridges was essential for us to conclude at this stage that we are managing that risk in an effective and proportionate manner. However, it is essential that we keep this risk under close review. And to be clear, this must cover the possibility of importation from other parts of the UK as well as from overseas. Presiding Officer, taking all of these various factors into account, I can confirm that it is the judgment of the government that we can now move from phase 2 to phase 3 of the route map. I can also confirm that we will allow in a limited number of sectors an exception to be made to the requirement for 2 metre physical distancing. However, this will be subject to strict conditions tailored to the circumstances of each sector. And let me stress the term exception. The general rule remains 2 metres. For public transport and the retail sector, this exception will be permissible from tomorrow. However, it is essential that the required mitigations are in place and that appropriate discussions have taken place with trade unions before it becomes operational in any particular setting. Given some of what I will cover later, it's also worth being clear at this point that the retail sector includes personal services such as hairdressing. I also want to remind everyone that face coverings, already mandatory on public transport, will from tomorrow be mandatory in shops as well. There will be some exemptions for young children under 5, people with certain health conditions, and for staff in some circumstances. For the vast majority of us, however, it will be the law that we wear face coverings in shops. Wearing a face covering on a bus, train, or in a shop should, for the foreseeable future, become as automatic as putting on a seatbelt in a car. It should not need to be enforced, but the police can issue fines for anyone not complying. However, I am asking everyone to comply, not from fear of enforcement, but because it is the right thing to do. It helps us protect each other from the virus. And that leads me to a general point that it is important to stress before I outline the further restrictions that we intend to lift. The virus hasn't gone away. It is still out there, and it is just as infectious and just as dangerous as it ever was. Lockdown has suppressed it, but as lockdown eases, there is a very real risk that it will start to spread again. And that is not conjecture. It is already happening in many parts of the world. And with every restriction we lift, the risk increases, especially as we start to permit more indoor activity. So all of us must do everything we can to mitigate it. Wearing face coverings is part of that, but so too are the other measures summarised in our Facts campaign. Face coverings, avoiding crowded spaces, cleaning hands and surfaces, 2 metre distancing and self-isolation and booking a test if you have symptoms. I simply cannot stress enough that as we move out of lockdown, these basic measures become much more important, not less. Please follow them to the letter. Presiding Officer, let me now confirm the key steps in Phase 3 for which we are now able to set specific dates. You will find more detail on the Scottish Government website later today. As will be obvious from what I am about to say, we intend to take the same staggered approach to Phase 3 as we did to Phase 2. Not all changes will happen immediately or at the same time. That means we are not bearing all of the risk at once. However, the first changes relating to the ability of different households to meet up together will take effect from tomorrow. The Health Secretary yesterday announced important changes for people who are shielding. For example, from tomorrow, you will no longer be asked to physically distance from people you live with, and you will be able to form an extended household if you live on your own or with children under 18. Today's route map includes a link to the additional changes we hope to make to the shielding advice up to the end of July. The other changes I'm about to announce do not apply to people who are shielding, unfortunately, but do apply to everyone else. Before I set out what these are, let me make a general point. Last week we said that children under 12 no longer had to physically distance when outdoors. From tomorrow, that will apply indoors too. However, for adults and for the time being older children, the advice to keep a 2 metre physical distance from people in other households will remain. But the general rules on household gatherings will from tomorrow be as follows. A maximum of 15 people from up to 5 different households can meet together outdoors. The advice is to remain 2 metres distant from people in households other than your own. And from tomorrow, limited indoor gatherings will also be permitted. A maximum of 8 people from up to 3 different households can meet indoors. To be clear, that is the household whose house the gathering is in and people from up to 2 additional households. As long as physical distancing between different households is maintained, this can include overnight stays. I must stress, though, that this is one of, if not the, highest risk change we have made so far. We know that the risk of transmitting the virus indoors is significantly higher than it is outdoors. So it is essential that we all take the utmost care and strictly follow all of the public health advice. That means keeping 2 metres distant from people in other households, being very careful to clean surfaces after you touch them, and washing your hands regularly, especially when you first enter someone's house. At all times, try to avoid creating bridges that allow the virus to spread from one household to another. We're also advising that between indoors and outdoors activity, adults don't meet with people from any more than 4 different households in any single day. Finally, from tomorrow, we will change the guidance so that people who are part of a non-cohabiting couple, regardless of their living arrangements, no longer need to stay physically distant from each other, indoors or outdoors. The next set of changes will take effect from Monday, 13th of July. From Monday, organised outdoor contact sports and physical activity can resume for children and young people subject to guidance being followed. And so too can other forms of organised outdoor play. Non-essential shops inside shopping centres can reopen, provided, of course, that they follow all relevant health and safety guidance. That will mean that the vast majority of retail from Monday will be open. There will also, from Monday, be a further resumption of important public services. Community optometry practices will further increase their services, especially for emergency and essential eye care. Dental practices will be able to see registered patients for non-aerosol procedures. And to explain that a bit more, aerosol procedures are those that create a fine mist, for example, through use of a high-speed drill, and we cannot yet allow these. Unfortunately, this means that many forms of dental care will still not be possible. However, procedures such as checkups and the fitting of dentures and dental braces can resume. And from Monday, a woman can have a designated person accompany her to ante and postnatal appointments, and in addition to her birth partner, can designate one other person to attend the birth and also make ante and postnatal ward visits. Further important changes will then come into force from Wednesday next week, that is the 15th of July. From that date, indoor restaurants, cafes and pubs will be able to reopen. However, just as with indoor household meetings, opening up indoor hospitality poses significantly increased risks of transmission. So it is absolutely essential that the guidance on health and safety is followed rigorously by businesses, by staff and by customers. That includes guidance on physical distancing and also taking customer contact details for use, if necessary, by Test and Protect. Like public transport and retail, outdoor and indoor hospitality venues will be granted an exemption from the 2-metre rule from the 15th of July. However, this is dependent on the implementation of all relevant mitigating measures and appropriate discussions taking place with trade unions. Mitigating measures in this sector include, for example, clear information for customers that they are entering a 1-metre zone, revised seating plans and improved ventilation. The tourism sector can also reopen from 15th of July. That means all holiday accommodation, including hotels, can reopen as long as the appropriate guidance is followed. Museums, galleries, other visitor attractions, libraries and cinemas, including drive-ins and other venues screening films, can also reopen on the 15th, although physical distancing and other safety measures will be required. And for many, if not most of these facilities, tickets must be secured in advance. The childcare sector can also fully reopen from next Wednesday, something that I know is important to families across Scotland. I can also confirm that from 15th of July, hairdressers can reopen subject to enhanced hygiene measures being in place, and the finalised guidance for hairdressers will be published this week. And finally, I am pleased that we are able to bring forward two changes that we were previously keeping under review for later in phase three, but that we now judge can be undertaken safely next week, provided that necessary mitigations are in place. After careful consideration, we have decided that from the 15th of July, places of worship can reopen for communal prayer, congregational services and contemplation. However, numbers will be strictly limited. 2 metres physical distancing will be required, and there will also be a requirement to collect the contact details and time of attendance of those entering a place of worship. And unfortunately, given what we know of transmission risks, singing and chanting will also be restricted. Detailed guidance is currently being finalised in consultation with our faith communities, but I hope that today's announcement will be welcomed by all those for whom faith and worship is important and a source of comfort. Presiding Officer, in addition to that, and indeed linked to that change, we will also ease restrictions on attendance at services and ceremonies for funerals, weddings and civil partnerships. However, numbers will be even more limited than for worship generally, and physical distancing will be required. And I must stress that this change applies only to services. Associated gatherings, such as wakes or receptions, must continue to follow the limits on household gatherings and hospitality. I am acutely aware that the restrictions we have had to place on attendance at funerals in these past few months have been particularly hard to bear, and I am very grateful to everyone who has complied in what I know will have been heartbreaking circumstances. And while the changes which come into effect next week will not allow full-scale gatherings yet, I hope they will allow more people to find solace at a time of grief, as well as allowing more people to celebrate happier occasions such as weddings and civil partnerships. The next set of changes, Presiding Officer, will take effect from the 22nd of July. At that time, personal retail services which have not yet been able to reopen, for example, beauticians and nail salons, will be able to reopen with enhanced hygiene measures in place. Universities and colleges can implement a phased return to on-campus learning as part of a blended model with remote teaching. Motorcycle instruction and theory and hazard tests can also resume from that date, but driving lessons and tests in cars, unfortunately, will have to wait a bit longer. Unfortunately, there are other activities which are included in phase three of the route map that we are not yet able to attach a firm and specific date to. However, while we will keep all of this under review, and as we have done with communal worship, bring dates forward wherever possible, it should be assumed at this stage that these other activities will not restart before the 31st of July. These activities include the reopening of non-essential offices and call centres, the resumption of outdoor live events, and the reopening of indoor entertainment venues such as theatres, music venues and bingo halls. They also include the opening of indoor gyms and the resumption of non-professional adult outdoor contact sports. We will continue to work closely with relevant sectors on the reopening as soon as possible of all these activities. For example, we work with the outdoor events sector to review the range of events that could take place, as we recognise a one-size-fits-all approach may not be appropriate. However, I hope it will be appreciated, however difficult I know this is, that a number of these activities present particular challenges. And while I do know it is difficult, it will take a bit more time to work through how these can be safely addressed. I also want to indicate at this stage that our current expectation is that phase three may well last longer than 3 weeks. Given the scale of the changes we are making in phase three, it may be wise not to rush that or to go into phase four too quickly, but we will keep that under close review. And let me reiterate that it is our ambition and our intention that schools will return full time in August. Indeed, this is dependent on the virus continuing to be suppressed to very low levels, and therefore it is one of the reasons we are being so careful and cautious in everything else we do right now. Presiding Officer, there's no doubt that today's statement marks the most significant milestone yet in Scotland's emergence from lockdown, and I hope that the measures we have announced or confirmed today are welcome. All of them, of course, depend on us keeping the virus under control. Eliminating it as far as we possibly can now, ahead of the, I'm afraid to say, almost inevitable challenges we will face come winter, remains our objective. And we will not hesitate to reimpose restrictions if we consider it necessary to halt the spread of the virus and save lives. I will, of course, make a further statement to Parliament on the 30th of July, and of course, between now and then, we'll deliver updates through the regular media briefings. However, I want to end by stressing the point I made at the outset, and it is perhaps the most important point of all. This is undoubtedly a time for cautious hope and optimism. There is no doubt that Scotland, through our collective efforts, has made great progress in tackling COVID. We should all savour our first indoor meetings and meals with friends, our first pint in a pub, or catch up over coffee. Many of us, I know, are looking forward to our first non-amateur haircut in many months. And there will be other milestones and reunions that we will enjoy over the next few weeks. They have all been hard-earned by each and every one of us. But, Presiding Officer, I have a duty to be crystal clear with the country that this is also a time of real danger. Next week represents the most substantial easing of lockdown so far, and we know that meeting people indoors poses far greater risk than going to a park or to someone's garden. And as I said earlier on, we see signs of resurgence in many countries across the world right now. So we must all be aware of that in everything we do. We must remember that COVID, although currently at very low levels in Scotland, is still out there. And everything we learn about this still new virus, about its infectiousness, its ability to kill, and its potential to do long-term damage to health, should warn us that we mess with it at our peril. And so perhaps more than ever, now is a time for great caution. Remember that life should still not feel entirely normal. And at all times, especially when we are meeting indoors with people in other households, we must be constantly alert to the steps we need to take to deny it the chance to spread. And that's why the most important thing everyone must remember and abide by is facts. Face coverings must be worn in enclosed spaces, public transport, shops, and indeed anywhere else that physical distancing is more difficult. Avoid, literally like the plague, crowded places, indoors or outdoors. Clean your hands regularly and thoroughly, and clean hard surfaces after touching them. 2 metre distancing remains the clear and important advice. And self-isolate and book a test immediately if you have symptoms of COVID. The symptoms to be aware of are a new cough, a fever, or a loss of or change in your sense of taste or smell. You can book a test at nhsinform.scot or by phoning 0800 028 2816. And please act immediately and err on the side of caution. If you have any reason at all to worry that you might have COVID symptoms, get tested straight away. It is only because of our collective action, our love for and solidarity with each other, that we have made so much progress. Now is not the time to drop our guard. So let's all keep doing the right things to keep ourselves safe, to protect others and to save lives. Thank you.
Thank you very much. There's already quite a lot of interest in asking questions. I would encourage all members who wish to do so, though, to press their request to speak buttons. Jackson Carlow.
I thank the First Minister for her early sight of her statement, and I would reiterate the call, as we exit lockdown, for all of us to follow the rules, as commendably, really, the vast majority have across Scotland so far. And I particularly welcome hearing that places of worship will soon be reopened, a sign that our communities are coming back to life. Today's statement confirms that businesses and employees across many sectors can now plan to return to work. So let me first ask the First Minister about her decision to put her commitment to expanded free childcare on hold. For many of those employees are parents who've waited nearly 5 years for this policy to be enacted as promised, and this will come as a deep disappointment. And it comes when we need to do all we can to make it as easy as possible for parents to get back into the workplace as we all seek to get Scotland back on its feet. Now, the First Minister said she will review the position in December. That's still 5 months away. And I'm asking whether that review could not take place sooner to give parents returning to work now hope that this promised policy may yet be delivered before the end of the coming school year.
First Minister.
Our commitment to double the provision of state-funded childcare, a commitment that hasn't been made by any other government anywhere else in the UK, is not on hold. It has inevitably had to have a re-evaluated timescale because of the impact of COVID, the interruption to construction work, and of course the obligation on local authorities, who of course are in the lead in terms of implementing and delivering this policy, the obligation that they have had to divert resources to tackling and dealing with the pressures of COVID. So we are simply being frank with people about the inevitable and unavoidable consequences of that. As I said yesterday, we will of course keep that under review. We will look for all opportunities to accelerate progress. This is a commitment, the flagship, if you like, commitment of this government, and I want to see it delivered as quickly as possible because I know the benefits it will deliver to young people as they go through their school education and the rest of their lives, but I also know the financial benefit that it will deliver to families at a time, of course, when that financial benefit will be very necessary and very welcome. So, as I've tried to do throughout this crisis, I've tried to be straight about the challenges we face and set out the reasons why some things that we would like to happen can't happen or can't happen in a particular timescale, and I will continue to keep the public updated in that open and frank way. But we will continue to be committed to delivering that policy, and when we do, I hope Jackson Carlow will be one of the first to welcome it.
Jackson Carlow.
Well, I'll hope from that answer that that does potentially mean that that review date can be brought forward even by a couple of months. Can I turn to some of the detail of the Chancellor's summer statement yesterday? And Scotland will benefit hugely from many of his actions, such as the job retention bonus, the VAT cut for hospitality sector, and the eat out to help out scheme. However, his decision to cancel stamp duty on home sales up to 500,000 does not benefit Scots because it is devolved. Now, his plans are a welcome step, not just for home buyers, but also for those employed people that we want to see getting back to work. Very often, self-employed tradespeople, joiners, plasterers, electricians, who we're hoping that as they come out of lockdown, there is work for them to do. And they often rely upon an active housing market for that work. Will the Scottish Government match this action?
First Minister.
Well, the Finance Secretary will set out the Scottish Government's response to the Chancellor's statement yesterday in this chamber this afternoon, and I will allow her to do that. We welcome, as we did yesterday and I have done throughout this crisis, the interventions that have been made. As far as they go, they are all important and all welcome, and we will continue where there are consequentials from these announcements to deliver the benefits of those consequentials here in Scotland, as we have done throughout on stamp duty, LBTT, as it is in Scotland. Of course, as we make decisions on that, we will take account of the different structure of the housing market in Scotland, and we are also particularly mindful. I read some comment from the IFS this morning about the need to be careful around the impact of this on first-time buyers in particular. So these will all be issues that the Finance Secretary will address later. In terms of the consequentials, and let me say, every single penny is welcome, but the additional cash, particularly around the employment aspects of the Chancellor's announcements yesterday, delivered to the Scottish Government amounts to, and this, I saw this confirmed by the Fraser-Valander Institute this morning, amounts to around £21 million. We will make sure every penny of that benefits people in Scotland. But we want to look to see what more we can do over and above that. We are, over the course of this month, going to be formulating a response to the report of the Economic Recovery Advisory Group. And, of course, one of the central recommendations in it was to a job guarantee for younger people. Yesterday's announcement goes part of the way to that. But, of course, we want to look to see if we can go further in Scotland and deliver something of scale and ambition that can avoid us seeing a legacy from COVID of increasing and substantial youth unemployment.
Jackson Carroll.
Let me ask about the First Minister's decision yesterday to keep Spain off the list of countries exempt from quarantine. As the First Minister knows, the Scottish Tourism Alliance has described the decision as a blow to the aviation sector and the tourism industry. And she will know, because she expressed it yesterday, the disappointment felt by, I understand, some 60% of holidaymakers who would have had plans to visit Spain this summer. Now, the decision extends to all Spanish destinations, including the Canary Islands, which includes Gran Canaria, Lanzarote, Tenerife, and then on to La Gomera, and the Balearic Islands, which includes Mallorca, Menorca, and Ibiza, all of which have a very low incidence of COVID, in some cases significantly lower than Scotland. Will she examine whether these popular destinations could be added to her list of quarantine countries now? And I think such a measure would be welcomed by many Scots who do understand the need to balance and the actions she took arising from the incidents in mainland Spain, with the risk here just as much as we do.
First Minister.
I was starting to wonder there whether Jackson Carlow was outlining his own summer holiday plans there. I also was particularly interested in what appeared to be a proposition from Jackson Carlow that where there are different prevalence rates within a different country, then different arrangements around travel should apply. And perhaps that is something that Jackson Carlow may want to reflect on in different circumstances in future. Recognising, of course, that right now Scotland has a prevalent rate of this virus that is several times, based on the most recent data we have, five times lower than the rest of the UK. I'll be very straight, as I was yesterday, on the decision about Spain. I understand how difficult this is for our aviation sector, our tourism sector, and indeed those who might want to go overseas over this summer, although my advice to people in Scotland, if you want to go on holiday, support the Scottish tourist industry by staying in Scotland to have a holiday if you are able to. But, you know, right now we don't have yet sufficient data broken down to subdivide Spain into different areas. One of the things I said yesterday is we want to work to try to develop that picture so that we may be able to take a more targeted decision in the very near future. But yesterday I had data in front of me that showed that the prevalence rate of this virus in Spain right now is more than 10 times higher than it is in Scotland. Now, Jackson Carlow may want to argue that that should just be ignored and we should cast that aside, but I would point to something that I said in my opening remarks. We have, as we go from one phase of the route map into another, one of the things that we assess ourselves against are the WHO six criteria. And one of those, and the one that was most difficult for us to give that assessment on this week, was guarding against the risk of importing infection from other countries. So the decision yesterday was vital to give us that assurance to enable, at this stage, that move into phase three. But we will continue to assess that and seek as granular a picture of the situation in different countries as we can. And that's not just about prevalence, because as Jackson Carlow, I'm sure, is aware, there are two factors at play here, prevalence and any particular circumstances around outbreaks or approaches in controlling the infection, and there is work ongoing amongst the four chief medical officers across the UK right now to allow us to make more targeted assessments on that basis too.
Jackson Carlow.
Well, I think that was a bit disappointing, because the prevalence in some of the Spanish islands is significantly less than here in Scotland. And the difference, of course, between Spain and the islands is that there is 1,000 miles of water, which there isn't between Scotland and England, however much the SNP might wish it otherwise. What people will have noticed yesterday was the gap between the negative response from some MP politicians to the Chancellor's statement, particularly at Westminster, and the positive response from Scotland. On the Kickstart Youth Employment Programme, the SNP said, "It's a kick in the teeth." From Liz Cameron at the Chambers of Commerce, "A practical step in the recovery." On the hospitality and tourism VAT cut, the SNP said, "Not enough." From the Scottish Tourism Alliance, "A huge catalyst for the tourism economy and a huge relief." On oil and gas, the SNP claimed the Chancellor's statement was a hammer blow and shameful. But from Oil and Gas UK, "We welcome this support for companies in the offshore oil and gas industry." What Scotland's now looking for is prompt, radical and ambitious action from this government to support our tourism industry, to keep young people in jobs and to rebuild our country. So when the Finance Secretary sets out her plans later, rather than complaining about what she can't do again, will she set out what she can do and what she must do for Scotland?
First Minister.
The most important thing this government needs to do for our tourism sector, for our economy, for society generally, and frankly for every individual in the country, is to provide the most sustainable basis for the recovery from the COVID crisis. And I know Jackson Carlow will never ever accept that anything this government does is any good at all, but anybody who wants to take a step back from this will see that right now Scotland is being successful in tackling and suppressing this virus, perhaps more than is the case elsewhere in the UK, and we need to continue on the approach that has achieved that so that we build that sustainable basis for recovery. And Jackson Carlow is, I think from a sedentary position, said I should have listened to what he said earlier on. He should have listened to what I said as well, perhaps, which is that I welcome the Chancellor's announcements yesterday as far as they go. But I reserve the right to point out, as my colleagues have done, that if you compare the totality and the scale of the fiscal stimulus in terms of its proportion of GDP, it does fall short of what many other countries are doing. And I think all of us have a duty to point that out. And we want to make sure that there continues to be a response from the Chancellor, because he holds the borrowing powers, he holds the vast bulk of the financial levers right now, that there is a response to the economic crisis that is commensurate with the scale of the challenge that we face. And here in Scotland, as we have done since day one, we will apply whatever consequentials there are in a way that supports Scotland, the economy and other parts of the country, and we will look to see what more we can do to add to that response. And that's very much the spirit in which the Finance Secretary will set out her statement this afternoon. As a government, whether it's on the health crisis or the economic challenge flowing from that, or the many other aspects that flow from that, this government is absolutely focused on getting the country through this as safely as possible. And I believe the vast majority of people across Scotland support us in that endeavour. And in fact, we would not be making the progress we are making now without not just the support, but the cooperation of everybody across Scotland, for which they all have my grateful thanks.
Question two, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank the First Minister for advance sight of her statement? And can I also remind members of my register of interests. Back in June, the Scottish Government announced it was establishing a Rolls-Royce working group to protect jobs under threat at Inchinnan in Renfrewshire. And on the 3rd of June, the First Minister told Parliament she would, I quote, "work very closely with trade unions," and spoke of, I quote again, "a Team Scotland approach." And I'm sure the First Minister believed what she said at the time, but she was wrong. The Scottish Government's Rolls-Royce Working Group does not include one single Rolls-Royce trade union representative. So if it was a team, it was a team that didn't include the players. This is not just about the future of a site. It is about the future of jobs. Jobs at a time when Scotland is on the precipice of a major unemployment crisis. It's about the future of work in Scotland and the future of workers in Scotland. The Rolls-Royce workers are lobbying Parliament today. I spoke to Tam Mitchell, the Unite Union convener, just a few minutes ago. Tam has worked for Rolls-Royce for nearly 35 years. And he asked me to ask you directly this question. We face the loss of 550 jobs and a business closure in a matter of weeks. First Minister, can you now share with the workforce what has been done to secure their jobs?
First Minister.
Can I say, first of all, if there is a concern about the membership of the task force, I will take that away and we will look to address that. There is no interest on the part of the Scottish Government at not having everybody involved in a collective effort to do everything we can to secure jobs and, if it is at all possible, to secure the Rolls-Royce presence in Scotland. In terms of what's been done, I personally spoke to the Chief Executive of Rolls-Royce a few weeks ago. We have established with the company a working group which is looking at a number of things. Firstly, what the Scottish Government can do in the short term to try to protect jobs. And I can't stand here and pretend otherwise than Rolls-Royce globally is facing huge challenges in terms of a fallen demand for what it does. And we cannot magic that away, unfortunately. But we have committed to look at what can be done in the short term. But also, importantly, I think this working group is looking at the medium to long term and whether the Rolls-Royce presence in Scotland can be repurposed into, for example, electric provision in the future and technology, and what we may be able to do together to provide a bridge between the short term and the medium to longer term. That work is ongoing, and of course the task force will have a role to play in feeding into that. We shouldn't be seeing this as a point of tension between us, particularly not Richard Leonard and I. We are absolutely, I hope, on the same side in this. The Scottish Government, as we have done in the past with other major parts of our industry that have been under threat, we will leave no stone unturned and we will do everything we possibly can to protect jobs, to retain jobs, and if possible to retain as many as we feasibly can. But I don't do anybody any favours, and neither does Richard Leonard, if we underplay the challenges and the particular nature of the challenges in the aviation sector right now. So I hope we will have the ability to work together. And as I said at the outset, if there are genuine concerns that we've not got some things right along the way, particularly when it comes to the membership of a task force, I'm very happy to address that and to address it quickly.
Richard Leonard.
Thank the First Minister for that answer. Tam Mitchell also said to me, he said, I have been told officially by the company that maintenance, repair and overhaul, MRO, is not even on the agenda of these meetings because the First Minister's office was told by Warren East, the CEO of Rolls-Royce, that those jobs are gone. Well, a Scottish Government Rolls-Royce working group to protect jobs at Rolls-Royce should not have written 700 Rolls-Royce jobs off. There's another lobby of Parliament today about jobs, and it's by aviation workers from Scotland's airports, organised by the GMB trade union. Some of them are employed by Menzies Aviation. This is a company continuing to claim 100% business rates relief from the Scottish Government, whilst at the same time attempting to fire and rehire its own workers with their terms and conditions slashed by almost a half. Pamela Ritchie, who is demonstrating outside Parliament today, has worked at Glasgow Airport for 15 years. Pamela works for Swissport. 800 Swissport jobs out of 1,000 in Scotland are at risk. And Pamela told me, everyone understands how difficult the situation is for air travel. But to be losing so many airport jobs without any action from the Scottish Government to help us feels like we are the collateral damage in the coronavirus crisis. First Minister, we cannot continue to see more workers feel like collateral damage during this pandemic. So will you work with the aviation trade unions and not just the airport owners and operators? Will you make 100% business rate reliefs conditional on good employment practices? And will you listen to these workers, meet these workers, before more jobs are lost?
First Minister.
I don't know where Richard Leonard's been this week, but I'm not sure I'm the most popular person in Scotland with the airport owners this week either. This is the nature of the difficult decisions we have to take. Before I come on to aviation, let me round off on Rolls-Royce, because what Richard Leonard quoted at me there from Warren East, who's the chief executive that I spoke to a few weeks ago, relates to the fact, as I said in my initial answer, that Rolls-Royce, that the demand for the MRO services has plummeted, and that's part of the challenge. Now, we want to try to work to make sure that if there are things that can be done to protect jobs in the short term, we do that. I think there is also an even more important responsibility to try to work with the company to repurpose that facility for the longer term so that we can try to secure that presence, not just in the short term, but for a time to come. And we will continue to look at every option there, but I'm not going to stand here and pretend to anybody that these are easy challenges to overcome, given the global circumstances that are contributing to them. And the similar point has to be made with aviation. There has been, for reasons that we've just been reflecting on, a collapse in demand for international air travel. I hope to see that recover as we come out of the COVID crisis, although obviously we've got climate change responsibilities we need to meet as well. So the recovery part of this is the most important. We will work with all companies to do everything we can to protect jobs, but we cannot snap our fingers and take away the global reasons that these challenges exist. And I will listen to any practical suggestions that anybody wants to make about the things the Scottish Government can and should be doing. And on the issue of business rates relief, of course, there are always difficult decisions to make here. We want to support as many companies through this as we can, but we have been very clear. In fact, Fiona Hislop and the STUC agreed Fair Work Principles at the start of this. We are absolutely clear that any company, not just through this crisis, but generally, that is in receipt of public funding should have fair work practices absolutely embedded in what they do. And we will continue to send that message loudly and clearly to all companies, both during and after the crisis.
Richard Leonard.
Thank you. Let me turn to another aspect of jobs, finally, and that's on yesterday's statement by the Chancellor of the Exchequer, who announced the UK government's new Kickstart Jobs Scheme. Does the First Minister share my concerns that this will deliver low-paid, part-time employment for just 6 months in a scheme which cuts off everyone over the age of 24 when what we need are jobs for good and a quality jobs guarantee? Last week, the First Minister announced that Sandy Begbie would draw up an implementation plan for the Jobs Guarantee Scheme recommended by the government's Economic Recovery Advisory Group. So can the First Minister assure us right now that the jobs and training delivered by this scheme will last longer than 6 months? That those on it will be paid the living wage or the union-negotiated rate for the job? That they will be offered full-time employment or training? And with unemployment in Scotland now above the UK average, will she roll out such a quality jobs guarantee scheme as a matter of great urgency?
First Minister.
The principles that Richard Leonard outlined there are principles we seek to apply across all of our interventions around skills and youth employment, not just a potential jobs guarantee, but also our interventions through colleges and universities. That is important to us, and it always has been and always will be. In terms of the Chancellor's announcement yesterday, I do share some of the concerns that Richard Leonard has expressed. I think the announcement can hopefully play a part in a more comprehensive job guarantee scheme, and that's why the work that we are now doing to respond. And on the point of urgency, we will respond to Benny Higgins' report, which includes the recommendation of a jobs guarantee before the end of this month. But the implementation work, we want to see that jobs guarantee be more comprehensive than what was outlined yesterday. I suppose one of the points that I'm not sure, and maybe I misunderstood him, that I would, of course, we don't want to see unemployment rise for any section of the population, but on the age point that Richard Leonard made there, I do think it's important we have a particular focus on younger people, because the challenge of youth unemployment is likely to be even greater than it is generally, and like I'm sure is the case with Richard Leonard, I remember too well from my own youth the scarring effects of youth unemployment, and we must do everything we can to avoid that. So the point I wasn't sure I agreed with was his criticism of the 24 age point. But again, this is something that I hope, while yes, scrutiny and parliamentary debate has an important role to play, I hope that on these issues there will be lots more that unite myself and Richard Leonard and his colleagues than ever divide us. We are on the same side here. We may have slightly different views sometimes on how we go about it, but we all want to make sure that the generation of young people right now do not pay the long-term price for a crisis that is not of their making.
Alison Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm sure that this Parliament will wish to send its sincerest sympathies to the family and friends of 3-year-old Xander Irvine, whose funeral took place in Edinburgh this morning. the huge number of people who turned out on Morningside Road to pay their respects is testament to the love the community has for Xander and his family. He will never be forgotten. First Minister, yesterday, the Minister for Children and Young People tweeted that children aren't yet able to attend blended placements unless essential to support critical childcare. I warmly welcome the First Minister's confirmation in the statement today that the childcare sector can fully reopen from next Wednesday. But can the First Minister confirm that this reopening means that it will be possible to move from one childcare setting to another? The Scottish Childminding Association, its members and parents urgently need clarity in this regard. Thank you.
First Minister.
Can I, first of all, associate myself completely with Alison Johnson's comments about the tragic death of little Xander Irvin. None of us, I don't think, in this chamber can come close to understanding the heartbreak and devastation that his parents are suffering right now. I saw on social media the pictures of people lining the streets for his funeral this morning, and I just think all of us really struggle to find the words to convey the sense of sympathy we feel for everybody who loved the little boy, and I'm sure the thoughts of everybody across the chamber are with his family today and for a long time to come. On Alison Johnson's substantive point, and it's an important one, we absolutely hear and understand the concerns that have been expressed by the Childminder Association. On the point about blended spaces, we are not immediately changing that rule, but it is one we are reviewing and taking scientific advice as we do so, and I would hope that over the course of the next couple of weeks we will move to change that rule so that young people, children at Childminders are able to go from one setting to another. But I hope Alison Johnson will understand that, notwithstanding the very real and understandable views that have been expressed by Childminders, we have to do that carefully and on the basis of the best possible evidence. From my memory, I'm looking at him to check if it's correct, the Deputy First Minister will make a statement in Parliament in 2 weeks' time around education, and I'm sure this will be one of the many matters that he updates the Chamber on then.
Alison Johnson.
Thank you. I appreciate the First Minister's comments, but the lack of clarity around childminding is threatening the viability of many businesses and opportunities. First Minister, residents of tenements across Scotland have had a welcome respite from commercial short-term lets operating in their stairs for the past 3 months. And my colleague Andy Whiteman wrote to the First Minister yesterday highlighting testimony from residents sharing their stairs with short-term lets, describing antisocial behaviour, including fighting, spitting in stairwells and receiving threatening messages. Now, today's announcement means that all holiday accommodation will be open next week. So will the First Minister share the scientific advice confirming that it is safe to open up residential buildings where elderly and vulnerable residents are still shielding to unregulated and out-of-control businesses operating in them? Do you really think this is safe, First Minister?
First Minister.
I hope Alison Johnson will accept that I am and the government is taking great care in all of the decisions we are taking. None of them are easy, none of them are straightforward, and at any stage there is a view that we have not got any, some of them quite right, we are always willing to listen and to review that. Before I come on to that point more substantively, can I just close off the point about childcare, because this is not about somehow refusing to give clarity. The advice up until now has been that it's not safe. So if Alison Johnson is saying safety should be the key consideration in childcare right now, the advice up until now has been that it is not safe for children to move to one place to another. So if we're going to change that advice, we need to make sure we are doing it on the basis of the best possible evidence. And that's why it is taking a little bit longer to do it. What Alison Johnson has outlined in terms of Airbnb properties or houses that are let out in shared accommodation with shared facilities like tenements, that is not acceptable behaviour at any time during this crisis or at any time, and that behaviour has to be and must be tackled by the relevant authorities. Anybody who is using an Airbnb property has to comply with the same rules that I've just set out today and are clearly set out in our guidance as anybody else does. But of course, if there are concerns that are raised about the particular operation of any of the changes that we are announcing today, and if there is concern that these are risking a resurgence of the virus. These are concerns that we will act on. And, you know, none of what I've said today, and this is part of the difficulty I know for businesses and people across the country, none of it can be set in stone right now, because all of it depends on our continued assurance that we are driving this virus to the lowest levels possible.
Thank you. Willie Rennie.
For weeks, I've been making a positive, constructive case for a joined-up approach on childcare. Thousands of parents have been asked to go back to work without the childcare arrangements in place. So I am relieved that finally we may have something that might work. If physical distancing for under 12s indoors has gone and childcare is fully reopening next Wednesday, this may allow parents to get back to work. But the childminding advice needs to keep pace with the education advice as well, because the risk to the childminding sector is clear. More than 80% of childminders feared for their future. This is very serious. So I hope the First Minister will respond to that. The First Minister knows that I'm an advocate for good early learning and childcare, and that I support the expansion to 1,140 hours. I understood that because of the construction industry had shut, that many of the nurseries could not be built or refurbished in time for the expansion in August. I understood that. But I was surprised to learn that nursery expansion has therefore been delayed for a year. Why does a three-month lockdown result in a 12-month delay for parents, carers and children right across the country?
First Minister.
Let me address the first point about childminders, and I've addressed that substantively to Alison Johnson, so I won't repeat everything I've said. I don't want any childminder fearing for the future of the business. I don't want any business fearing for the future, where we can do something to avoid that. But equally, I don't want parents fearing for the health and safety of their children. And therefore, it is really important that as we take these decisions, we take them on the basis of the best possible evidence. That's why some of these decisions have taken longer than any of us would have liked. That is unavoidable. And this one, we are looking carefully at that, but we must make sure we are taking decisions that has the safety of children absolutely central to everything we do. And I'm sure Willie Rennie would agree with that. On the issue of the childcare expansion, I've again already addressed this earlier. This is not a uniform position. Some local authorities will be delivering this commitment very quickly or more quickly than others, and much more close to the original timescale. Beyond that, we will take every opportunity to accelerate this where we can. We cannot magic away the inevitable impact that COVID has had on these timescales, but nobody, certainly nobody in government, is keener than I and the Deputy First Minister to see this commitment delivered, and to see it delivered as quickly as possible. And we will work with local authorities to make sure that that can happen.
Willie Rennie.
But families are banking on the expansion to enable to get them back to work. Children have already missed out on education and nursery because of the lockdown for months. So the inequality gap continues to grow. And the price of delaying the rollout will be paid in lost opportunities by families and children right across the country. The First Minister says she wants to support an economic recovery. I have to say, there is no way to a strong recovery that does not include strong and growing childcare provision. Her Minister said this week that they signed off a statement that there would be no review until December. And after that, for 6 months, it would not change. A few minutes ago, the First Minister said that this was not fixed. So I want some clarity here. If it's not fixed, has the December review date gone? And has the 6 months notice gone as well?
I'm afraid Willie Rennie has been very constructive throughout this. I don't want to turn this into in any way a sort of adversarial exchange, so I accept that. But what I would say is the reality for almost every aspect of life right now is that nothing is fixed, and that's really difficult. We're trying to give people, we're trying, so in terms of the timescales that you talked about there, what we're trying to do, given that we have inevitably and unavoidably lost time over the COVID crisis in the delivery of this, we're trying not to raise expectations of parents right now before we know we can deliver on them. So probably this will happen in a range of different ways. We build a bit more time into things that we genuinely hope might be necessary. And that's just trying to strike a balance. But we will be doing everything here, as well as doing everything across a whole range of other responsibilities, to accelerate things as much as possible. But the uncertainties around this, both in terms of how plans can be recast and accelerated as quickly as possible, but also the uncertainties of what we are facing with the virus, are significant. Now, our key challenge over these next few weeks is not to allow this easing of lockdown to lead to a resurgence, because that sets everything back even more. But then we go into a winter period where the risks of a genuine second wave of this are significant. So I would love nothing more, believe me on this, I would love nothing more than to give people in every sector right now cast iron certainty about the future, given the uncertainty of the past 4 months. But it would be irresponsible of me to do that. So we try to build the most realistic timescale that we can, on the basis that where it proves possible, we will bring that forward if it's at all possible. And that will be the case with childcare, as it is the case for everything else that we're dealing with too.
Thank you. There's a large number of members who wish to ask questions. I would just urge everyone to be succinct. Annabel Ewing, to be followed by Liam Kerr. Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On the important issue of face coverings, with reports from the World Health Organization that the virus may in fact remain in the air for longer than previously thought, would the First Minister encourage people to wear face coverings in any location where they feel unsafe, as well, of course, as on public transport and in shops?
First Minister.
Yes, I would. And just briefly, actually, on the statement made by the WHO, I think 2 nights ago, which is not a definitive statement yet, it was in response to an opinion from a large number of scientists, but the statement that they are looking further into the issue of possible airborne transmission is of serious and significant concern. And I hope this isn't the case, but if at any stage the view of the WHO is that this virus can be transmitted through the air, and what that means is droplets. Our current understanding is that if somebody sneezes, then somebody can get infected immediately if they're not far enough away, or the droplets can rest on a surface, and if somebody touches it, they can get affected. If it turns out that this could be airborne, what that means is if somebody sneezes, the droplets can stay in the air for quite some time, and then somebody coming into the same room, perhaps a couple of hours later, would still be at risk. Now, that would pose significant challenges for us in how we manage this. So just to put it on Parliament's radar, that this is something that is now under active consideration by the scientific community. But it does underline, and Annabel Ewing is right, it underlines the importance of wearing face coverings in enclosed spaces. And I would reiterate the point about this being law as of tomorrow in shops, as it already is in public transport. But don't do it just because it's the law and just because it can be enforced and you can be fined by the police if you don't do it. Do it because it's the right thing to do. If you wear a face covering in an enclosed space, and that should be any enclosed space where you feel a bit uncomfortable or where physical distancing is difficult, then it protects other people from you passing the virus to them, and other people wearing one protects you. So please wear face coverings in enclosed spaces, because it is collectively helping us to protect everybody.
Liam Kerr, followed by Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On Monday, the First Minister confirmed that not a single follow-up check had been conducted on international arrivals coming into Scotland. 2 weeks ago, her Justice Secretary told the Health and Sport Committee that quarantine checks had taken place on approximately 20% of travellers. Instead of taking responsibility and apologising, he's blamed his officials and even Police Scotland for these inaccurate statements. Will the First Minister promise today to publish in full the advice the Justice Secretary was given from both his officials and Police Scotland, so we can establish precisely the truth of this matter?
First Minister.
Well, the matter is as set out by the Justice Secretary. What he said was what he believed was going to be the case, that the checks were starting on that day, or in fact had started the day before. We now know, and I've narrated this publicly on more than one occasion in the last few days, that it took longer than we had thought it would take to agree the memorandum of understanding with the Home Office that allows those checks to be carried out. And Hamza Yousaf has set that out. Also, at the time, he spoke to the committee. At that point, there had been no referrals to the police for non-compliance with these regulations. But, you know, more importantly, the member may be interested to know that as of at 10:15 today, 94 of these checks had been made since they started earlier this week. 72 are in progress. The case Reports indicate that contacts are aware that they should self-isolate and that there's high compliance with that. So I know the Conservatives don't like good news on these matters, but there's some good news for them to enjoy today. And again, I come back, Presiding Officer, to a central point here. If the Conservatives' proposition here is that everything the Scottish Government is doing is somehow not good enough, then the question they have to answer is, how is it that prevalence of this virus in Scotland is 5 times lower than it is in England?
Monica Lennon to be followed by Bruce Crawford. Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. An investigation by The Courier has today revealed that senior health officials regularly raise concerns about PPE stocks before coronavirus hit Scotland. We still don't have firm dates for the full remobilisation of all NHS services, and concerns are growing about non-COVID health risks, including excess cancer deaths and a mental health time bomb. Can the First Minister advise whether PPE stock levels are a barrier to restarting NHS services? Will we have enough PPE to cope with winter pressures and a possible second wave? And can she advise when face-to-face mental health services will return?
First Minister.
The Health Secretary will keep the Chamber updated on the remobilisation of the NHS and the resumption of routine health appointments. But on the direct question, no, lack of PPE is not a reason for not resuming services. And you know, I would remind Monica Lennon and indeed the whole Chamber that at no point during this crisis has Scotland run out of any aspect of PPE. We have worked hard to make sure the supplies are there. We've worked hard overcoming challenges that we have faced along the way. We readily acknowledge that to make sure the distribution is getting to where it's needed, and where we've had to make changes to that, we have made those changes. Along the way, that has also involved the revalidation of some items of PPE that had been date expired, and we've done all of that and made sure that the staff working in our NHS have the PPE they need, and we will continue to take that responsibility very seriously.
Bruce Crawford to be followed by Jamie Halker-Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, you may be aware that last weekend more than 20 people were charged with irresponsible camping and environmental damage in the areas of Lough Erne, Vennaker and Ard, all in my constituency. Not only was there large-scale littering with tents, sleeping bag and camping seats discarded, but fire damage was also caused to trees. First Minister, do you agree with me that while individuals may have wanted to let off a bit of steam following the easing of lockdown, such behaviour at any time is totally unacceptable and will not be tolerated? And if the individuals involved are found guilty, then the full weight of the law should come down on them.
First Minister.
Yes, I agree with that. The behaviour that Bruce Crawford has outlined there is not acceptable at any time, and it should be dealt with seriously where it does happen. But I would make the point that at this particular time, behaviour like that, or any of us that are behaving in a way that is not in compliance with the normal rules and laws or with the public health guidance that is in place right now, we are potentially, and I'm not exaggerating here, we are potentially putting other people's lives at risk. And all of us have a duty, an individual duty and responsibility, to make sure that we're not doing that, to make sure that we are thinking very carefully about how we're behaving and the application of public health measures. And if every single one of us does that, then we continue to reduce and to minimise the risk of this virus spreading out of control again, because that risk is very, very real. And I can't emphasise this enough. Anybody who doubts that need only look at large numbers of states in America right now. They need only look at Melbourne. They need only look at parts of Spain. They need only look at Serbia, Belgrade in particular. Growing parts of the world are having resurgences of this virus. It's not a second wave. That danger is there for us in the winter. This is because behaviour is meaning that as lockdown eases, the virus is finding it too easy to spread. And we must all be conscious of that in every decision we make right now.
Jamie Halker-Johnson to be followed by Neil Bibby.
We know that over 4,000 people in Scotland have lost their lives to COVID-19. And we know that there have been 2,000 lost in our care homes alone. What we don't know is how many Scots have had the virus. So can the First Minister advise me what programme of antibody testing is being undertaken in our care homes and amongst the general population? And given we are now more than 3 months into this crisis, if there isn't a programme, what plans are there to introduce one?
First Minister.
We are doing antibody testing for surveillance purposes right now, and the advice that we have is that that is the useful way right now of using antibody testing. That while the tests have become more reliable, the use of those in the wider population to tell individuals whether they've had the virus and, crucially, to tell them whether they have immunity to COVID, that we don't yet have the reliability for that to be a reasonable thing to do. And in fact, there was a letter written last week or the week before by a significant number of clinicians supporting the approach that I've just outlined, which is the one we're taking in Scotland. We've got to be really careful about this because, you know, even if we get to the point, and I think from my layperson's understanding, we are getting closer to the point where a test can tell you as an individual if you've got antibodies from COVID, we don't yet understand what that means. We don't understand whether that gives you immunity for a week, for a month, for a year, for 5 years, or at all. So we've got to be very careful about raising the public's expectations of what antibody testing in that individual way can do. But we are using antibody testing for surveillance, and we will continue to extend that programme as the science tells us it is useful and effective to do.
Neil Bibby, to be followed by Shona Robertson.
The First Minister has announced air bridges, but thousands of airport workers are facing losing their jobs. 2 weeks ago, following my last question to the First Minister, I wrote to her asking for her to urgently meet with the airport unions, GMB and Unite. I've still not received a reply. Menzies Aviation are putting Scotland to shame by their practices. Swissport workers are so dismayed they've came outside Parliament to demand action. First Minister, the Renfrewshire and West of Scotland economy simply cannot sustain airport job losses and Rolls-Royce job losses on the scale we are seeing. We were one of the worst hit areas by the virus, and many constituents are asking, why do we have to pay the economic price too? There are global challenges, of course, but right now there is no task force for Scotland's airports. There is no plan for Scotland's airports. First Minister, you've said you're open to suggestions. Will you therefore, at the very least, personally meet the airport union representatives to hear theirs?
First Minister.
I think if this hasn't been conveyed yet, I'm sure it's about to be. I think Jamie Hepburn is planning to meet the unions. I'm willing to meet unions. I meet all sorts of people, and we'll happily do that. But of course, I have a team of ministers because there's a lot of work the government has to do, and we want to be able to do all of it. On the issue, I understand acutely the severity of the challenges facing the aviation sector. I think, to be frank with Neil Bibby, simply, you know, referring to global conditions as if it's some kind of incidental matter doesn't do justice to the issue. One of the reasons why, you know, yesterday's decision on air bridges maybe doesn't sound as if it would have been, but it's one of the most difficult decisions the government's had to take in all of this so far, because, you know, public health tells us that the risk of importing this virus now is possibly the biggest health risk we face, and yet we understand the importance for the aviation sector of allowing international travel to start to resume, and therefore we had to make that balanced decision, and getting people able to travel again is one of the most important things we can do to help companies like Swissport and Menzies and airports and airlines. So these are not easy challenges, but we will continue to try to do everything we can, and we will work with trade unions and others to deal with some of the longer term implications of this. Anybody in my position in any country in the world who stands up and blithely says that we can wave a magic wand and take these challenges away is not doing justice to the issue. But we will, just as we have worked day and night for the last 3 months to tackle the virus, we will work day and night to do everything we can to mitigate and deal with the economic impact of it as well.
Shona Robertson, to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
As the First Minister said earlier, the Chancellor's announcement of a Kickstarter job creation scheme is a welcome start. However, given the disproportionate longer-term impact of COVID that's going to have on young people in particular, would the First Minister agree that young people across Scotland deserve and need more certainty than a six-month programme?
First Minister.
Yes, I do agree with that. You know, while I would repeat this, as Shona Robertson has there, my welcome for the Chancellor's announcement yesterday. We are looking right now in Scotland to see what we can do to build upon that, to give greater certainty and perhaps to give a longer term commitment to young people. Because as I've said before, including in response to Richard Leonard earlier on, all of the economic aspects of this are important and have to be addressed. But there's probably none more important than trying to avoid the scarring effect of a significant rise in youth unemployment, and we're very focused on trying to make sure that we deliver an intervention that is capable of avoiding that.
Graeme Simpson, to be followed by Polly McNeill.
Thank you. Driving lessons and tests in cars restarted in England on July the 4th. The First Minister said earlier that in Scotland we'll have to wait longer. But she didn't say why. Can she explain why that is and tell us what needs to happen in order to get things restarted?
First Minister.
This is a virus that spreads between people in close proximity to each other and people in different households in a car. I would have, with respect, thought that might have been obvious. Now, I don't underestimate the importance of this. The member's asked me why it's happening in England and it's not happening here. Let me turn that question around. Why is the prevalence of the virus 5 times lower in Scotland than it is in England? It is for the UK government to take the decisions they take. I have been at pains all along to say that I will not criticise them for the decisions they are taking, but I will not simply follow those decisions if I don't think they are right for the objective we have set of driving this virus to the lowest possible levels. So if we're going a bit slower on some things, it is because we think the risk of going faster is too great and will compromise what we are trying to do. And, you know, I've said this a couple of times, but I want to say it again just to be absolutely blunt with people. If we don't get this virus to the lowest possible levels now, then the situation we will face in winter, which for all countries may be significant regardless of what we do right now, but if we don't get it to the lowest possible levels right now, that challenge will be even more difficult to address and to hopefully overcome. So we'll do things and we will continue to do things at a pace that is consistent with trying to eliminate this virus. And other governments are perfectly entitled to take different decisions, but I would rather be standing up here today announcing, thankfully, nobody dying yesterday from this virus than if things were proportionate to England's position yesterday, being announcing that more than 10 people had died from this virus. So I'll continue to take decisions that I think are right for Scotland and protect the maximum number of lives.
Pauline McNeill to be followed by Sandra White. Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. According to the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, for those who rent their homes in the private rented sector, almost 45% have seen a drop in their incomes, and that is since March. But almost 60% have had to borrow or use up savings to pay rent. And it's the highest proportion of any housing tenure. And those are people who are already in arrears with other bills. Last week, the local government committee said they didn't have enough time to take my fair rents bill through the parliamentary process. And I feel that this legislation is never needed more than ever. And I hope the First Minister will at least accept that rent pressure zones have been a failure and we need something else. In view of that, will the First Minister consider adopting my bill and give stronger protection to renters? I accept that she can't give me an answer today, but at least if she could tell me that she would have a discussion with the Housing Minister. And if not, what action is the Scottish Government going to take to prevent renters in the private rented sector from high rents at this important time?
First Minister.
It's an important issue and one I'm acutely aware of generally across Scotland, but particularly given the nature of my own constituency, I know how important it is. We have taken over the last few years a number of measures to try to protect better those in the private rented sector, and we will continue to look at what more we can do. We've also, during this crisis, of course, increased the Scottish Welfare Fund and other sources of support for people who have financial difficulties, and I think that's important as well. Look, the local government committee took a decision. I'm not obviously can't interfere with the decision that the committee took. I will consider any reasonable suggestion that's made. I'll ask the Housing Minister to have a conversation with Pauline McNeill about whether anything around that is possible. I have to be frank, parliamentary time between now and the dissolution of Parliament is very, very limited, and there are some particular pieces of legislation, not least the incorporation of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child into domestic law that we want to prioritise before the end of this session. But we will look at what's possible, and if something is possible, we will certainly give that serious consideration.
Sandra White, to be followed by Mark MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the First Minister for her statement, in particular the mention of music venues. I also welcome earlier commitment of £10 million and a further commitment of £90 million to the arts, cultures and creative industries. However, music venues, which there are many in my constituency, will be one of the last to reopen. Can the First Minister therefore confirm that support will be made available for these venues?
First Minister.
Yes, it is undoubtedly the case that further support will be needed for music venues. because the impact of the pandemic has been devastating on not just venues, but the music industry more widely. Of course, people in the sector have benefited from some of the funding packages announced at the outset, such as the Pivotal Enterprise Resilience Fund, the Creative Tourism and Hospitality Enterprise Hardship Fund, and Creative Scotland's bridging bursaries. But we want to do more, and we're already in close contact with representatives of the industry to understand their specific needs in order that we can tailor further financial support. But there is no doubt further financial support will be necessary.
Mark MacDonald to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The lifting of restrictions is welcome because it demonstrates the progress that's being made, in particular around households being able to meet indoors. However, for individuals who have family members in care homes, there remain challenges and difficulties, and those are understandable. But I have a constituent whose mother is in a care home nearing end of life, unable to meet outdoors, which is the current situation in care homes, and who can only have one family member visiting when there are other members of the family, siblings, who would like to see her as she approaches end of life. Given the restrictions around face coverings, etc., will the First Minister give consideration to what flexibility care homes might be able to offer to families in the position that my constituent's family find themselves in?
First Minister.
The situation around visiting in care homes is a really difficult one, and the relaxation that the Health Secretary announced last week is important, but I know we want it as soon as it is safe to do so, to go further than that. What I would say to Mark MacDonald is there has all along been flexibility around end-of-life visiting, and if he wants to pass the details to the Health Secretary, we can see why that has not been accommodated in his constituent's case and how it can be accommodated in future. But end-of-life visits have always been recognised as being necessary and something that flexibility has always been available on.
Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, last weekend pubs reopened in England, bizarrely, from 6 a.m. Within 24 hours, at least three establishments were forced to close again due to customers testing positive for coronavirus. England's Police Federation Chair John Apter said what was crystal clear is that drunk people can't won't socially distance, adding that officers in some areas had been assaulted. Whilst most pubs will no doubt reopen safely and responsibly, how closely will they be monitored to ensure we see no repeat of scenes witnessed down south?
First Minister.
As I said a moment ago, it's for each of the governments across the UK to take decisions that they think are right. But in terms of our opening of hospitality outdoor earlier this week and indoor next week, we've chosen to do that during the week, Monday this week and Wednesday next week. So I think that's one thing that you can do to try to make sure that the transition into that is as safe as possible. I would urge everybody to behave responsibly. I think many people will be looking forward to going to a pub for the first time in a long time. But behave responsibly, because particularly if you're doing that indoors, then you are both taking and posing a greater risk than we have been taking over almost 4 months now. So you must comply with all of the measures that staff will be asking you to comply with, and remember to take care with your own personal hygiene and other measures as well. And of course, the police, as the police always do around hospitality, will take enforcement action where necessary and will police our pubs and clubs in a way, or pubs rather, in a way that is appropriate. And they will do that. They do that every time, but it is particularly important, I think, over this period that they do that in the sensitive and appropriate way that they always do.
Jamie Green to be followed by Neil Findlay.
Thank you. It's over 2 weeks since the Deputy First Minister announced that schools should plan to reopen fully on August 11th. But we already know that at least one local council will not be opening its doors fully on that date. So let me ask the First Minister, why has no further detailed guidance been issued since that announcement on how schools could open safely and fully? How many more councils might not also be opening their doors fully on August the 11th? But more importantly, what advice does she have for parents who had planned to return to work that day, but who now cannot?
First Minister.
The answer to the question, why is there not detailed guidance yet? Because we are working, the Deputy First Minister through the Education Recovery Group will be working on that guidance, making sure that we are taking account of all relevant scientific advice. It's really important that we do that in that very careful and considered way. Some local authorities may well decide to have a situation where younger people have a softer start into full-time education because they've been away from schools for 4 months, but the absolute intention is that schools will open full-time from August. And The final point I would make on this, which is probably the most important one, is that that is dependent on continuing to suppress the virus. And the thing that would put that most at risk is if I was to give in to some of the requests I get, not exclusively, but mainly from the Conservative benches, to speed up the exit from lockdown. That would jeopardise our suppression of the virus and actually do more than anything else to compromise our chances of getting education back full time. So if anybody out there is feeling frustrated at the pace of exit from lockdown, remember that that's the prize we're aiming for, getting our children back to full time education in August. So let's stick with it.
Neil Findlay to be followed by Willie Coffey.
One group of patients desperate to know what the reopening of the full NHS services mean for their health and well-being as Scottish mesh survivors. Yesterday's very good report by Baroness Cumberledge should have made very uncomfortable reading for surgeons, the medical profession, regulators, government ministers, manufacturers, and the medical establishment who have collectively failed women across Scotland, the UK, and indeed the world. Excuse me. The report includes a list of recommendations for the NHS in England, much of which can be implemented in Scotland too. So will the First Minister now take responsibility and urgently look at how we can implement the recommendations of the report in Scotland? Will she ensure that there is a debate in government time on the report immediately after recess? And will she commit to the NHS paying for women to travel abroad for full mesh removal, as the Canadian government have done?
First Minister.
The Health Secretary confirmed yesterday that we would consider the recommendations in the Cumberledge report for their applicability to Scotland, and we will respond in full to the report. I understand the Health Secretary has a meeting with certain members, I think including Neil Findlay, to discuss issues around mesh very soon. We will also continue to consider issues of how we support women to get the treatment that they feel and understandably and rightly feel that they need, and that will be part of that consideration. Of course, we have recently announced the establishment of a support fund to help women with some of the other costs associated with the difficulties around the mesh treatment that they have had. So the Health Secretary will be able to give a fuller update to the members she meets with next week, and I'm happy to give an undertaking that although it's for the Business Bureau to decide this, that there should be a parliamentary debate when it is appropriate and when we've had the chance to consider the recommendations in full and as soon as possible after the end of recess would be, I think, something that we could all support.
Willie Coffey to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you. Can I ask the First Minister a question on behalf of our shielded group, most of whom who have been isolating since March? They'll be pleased to learn of the latest relaxations announced yesterday, but could I ask the First Minister if more might be done with the tourism and hospitality sectors to think about setting aside safe zones or safe spaces for our shielders so that they might also be able to enjoy many of the facilities that the rest of us will shortly start to enjoy once again?
First Minister.
I think that's a good and reasonable suggestion that we'll certainly take up with different sectors. Willie Coffey's right about, you know, how difficult this has been and continues to be for those in the shielding category. So the changes that have been announced that will take effect from tomorrow are important, and I hope that they will make a real difference to the quality of life of people who are shielding. It's also the case that many in the shielded category who will be looking forward to the ability to interact more will also be very anxious and nervous about it. So we've produced guidance. We will continue to produce guidance. We've also produced guidance for the hospitality industry, which includes precautions such as regular disinfection and surfaces of objects and surfaces that are touched regularly. I think I said in my statement, but in case I didn't, just to remind anybody watching who is in the shielded category that on the government website today you will find more detail, not just about the changes that will take effect tomorrow, but the further changes that we hope we will be able to announce between now and the end of July, when it is still our hope that the shielding advice can be paused.
Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The First Minister will be aware that all deaf people, including those who use sign language, need to be able to see someone's face. Will she make sure that all transport providers and shop owners realise that they should not wear a face mask when someone has a hearing issue so that they can communicate clearly with them? And will she make sure that all NHS care workers have clear face masks so that lip reading can take place in an easy fashion?
First Minister.
Yeah, I think that is extremely important, and I think those points are well made. So I will give an undertaking to the member to make sure that we act on all of those, and the right guidance and support is available as he has set out. And I'm happy to ask the Health Secretary to write to him with more detail of that when we have done so.
And Jackie Bailey.
The First Minister, I'm sure, will agree that hospices have done a tremendous job during the pandemic, as they do all year round. They were promised additional resources back in April, some £19 million in Barnet consequentials. So can the First Minister tell me why some hospices have not yet received this money, and will she ensure that the funding is released immediately?
First Minister.
I will double check this, but the Health Secretary is indicating to me that it has already been agreed with the hospice sector that that money will be made available. But since Jackie Bailey seems to have different information, probably it's better if we go away and just double check where things are. But the intention to make sure that money is both available and released and distributed as appropriately is absolute.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid that's all we have time for now. Apologies to the members who didn't get a chance to ask their question. Parliament suspended. We'll resume at 2:30. Parliament is suspended.